Hello and welcome to the second part of my Repairathon. In the last part I showed you the box of mainboards I bought on eBay recently and ended up washing and repairing everything for the actual repair. If you missed that part, feel free to take a look at that one first. Meanwhile, a couple of days passed and the boards should be clean and dry again. I wanted to make this Repairathon short and crispy, but looks like my time is unfortunately quite limited and I have to schedule the repairs over a week or two. Of course, I will not be able to cut the videos instantly, but I will try to keep the time between the parts as short as possible. So, let's start with this one. It is a very nice slot 1 mainboard with an integrated graphics card. Last time I mentioned already some defects like scratches and a broken off memory module lever. Well, every repair should start with the identification. For this purpose, I always suggest the ultimate retro project. What we need now is to collect some information. This is a slot 1 mainboard. It is based on the Intel 440BX chipset. It has one ISO slot and 4 PCI slots, where one is not installed. This should be enough to identify the board. So, we go to the ultimateretro.net and select the mainboard search. Now we have to enter what we know. Chipset is by Intel. The model is 440BX. The processor socket type is slot 1. It has 4 PCI slots and 1 ISO slot. Now we select search with pictures. And we are getting 15 matches. And here it is, Intel RC440BX. Here we can find all kind of information like supported CPUs, remarks about the known issues, BIOS ROMs, documentation, pictures and all that kind of stuff. In the last part I said already that this must be an Intel board, but I was not sure about the exact model. And I also didn't know which graphics chip is used here. And here you go, it is an NVIDIA Riva 128ZX. It is documented to have up to 8 MB of video memory and this is exactly what is installed on this board. As you see, the heat spreader is banned quite a lot. And here is the bad news. As I was washing this board, I discovered that somebody tried probably to remove the heat sink with a screwdriver and damaged the graphics chip underneath. I'm quite confident that the graphics chip is damaged. Even if it looks like not much, in a close-up you clearly can see some damage traces. That is really sad, since this is a BGA chip and I have no equipment and, to be honest, no experience in exchanging such chips. Also, even if I would find a replacement, it is a very tedious job to replace such a BGA IC. Anyway, let's see if the board is alive at all. With some memory and a Celeron 433, which I use for testing, the setup should be ready to go. Oh, the PSU turned on as soon as I connected the cable. And as you see, we have some postcodes. This means that the board is at least partially alive. I connected the monitor and the keyboard. Let's see if we will get any video signal at all. And there is something, but unfortunately, as expected, the graphics chip is damaged and there are some vertical stripes on the display. That's bad news indeed. Unfortunately, this board has no AGP port, but for experimental purpose, let's insert a PCI graphics card and see if we will get a clean image. Yeah, and we do, just as expected. I will try to get into the BIOS, just to see how it looks like. Well, unfortunately that doesn't work as well. The monitor suddenly doesn't get any video signal at all. Well, this is a really sad story. This board is actually quite interesting, but as I already said, neither do I have a replacement for the graphics chip, nor am I able to resolder BGA chips with my equipment. The board has obviously other issues as well. I don't know if those are related to the damaged graphics chip, but even if not, currently I will not be able to repair this board completely anyway. So I will put it to my stash of spare parts. Either I will use it as a donor for another board, Or I will find a Riva 128ZX chip one day and try to replace it. Now I have quite a lot of more boards, which are waiting for a treatment. Just out of curiosity, I'll remove the heatsink. As you see, this one could be easily removed simply by rotating it. I really have no clue why someone had to go there with a screwdriver, but I showed you in the last part that there were some BIOS chips removed also on the other boards, and one socket was even broken in two. So no wonder to see such a damage here. Yeah, and as you see, the chip is indeed NVIDIA Riva 128ZX. And with the Creative Sound chip on board, this would be a nice Windows 98 system, but well, let's move on and see if we have some luck with another board. We have no time to lose. Which one's next? By the way, here are all the parts which I removed prior to washing the boards and which I will have to put back later. Well, I think let's continue with slot 1 mainboards. For example, with this nice Tyan AT mainboard. First of all, there is still one mounting stand on the board. Let's remove it. Okay. And I already see that the board is quite heavily bent. Do you see how twisted it is? That can lead to broken solder joints, especially on bigger SMD parts like chipset. Well, I wonder if this can be straightened again without further damage. So, there are some bent pins on the board and I usually use this tool, which I got in this set with some cheap soldering iron which I bought years ago. It has such a split tip and it is very handy if you need to straighten some bent pins. Of course, you can also use a pair of tweezers, but should you have something like this, it is a nice helper. The CPU slot got some slight damage as well, but I don't think this is critical. On the back, everything looks fine. I don't see any scratches or other damage. As you see, the keyboard connector is ripped off a little bit and has to be fixed. Okay, here is my test CPU once again. I removed the cooler to see if the CPU gets warm when powered up. A little bit of a contact cleaner is a good idea as well. If the contacts were dirty, I suggest to put the CPU in and out a couple of times. So we will need a post code analyzer, ATX power cable, and we are good to go for the first run. Some numbers are running on the post analyzer already. And we have some beep codes, probably because of missing memory. That's a good sign, means the CPU gets powered and the mainboard is alive, at least to some extent. Let me turn it off before the CPU gets really hot. Yeah, it is already quite warm. Let me add a CPU cooler, some memory, and a graphics card. It's gonna be the AGP S3 Trio 3D, which I got donated by a friend and which I showed in one of my recent videos. Yay, only one beep means system was initialized properly and there seemed to be some video signal as well. Well, looks good so far. The CPU was detected, a Celeron 450A for some reason. It is actually a Celeron 433 if I remember right, but that is probably due to the old BIOS and missing CPU IDs. Anyway, the system posts and complains about wrong CMOS settings and missing keyboard, obviously because both are currently not connected. Before I connect the keyboard, I will have to fix the port, which was ripped off a little bit. Desoldering with a right tool is an easy task and is done in a blink of an eye. I always add some fresh solder to the joints, which makes the desoldering even easier. The keyboard port itself seems to be okay, but the two legs on the front, which were going from the metal shielding to the ground, are broken off, so the port was held in place only by the actual connector pins. I could replace the port completely, but I think I can repair this one. So, I bent the edge to the front, then I added some flux and a blob of solder, then I made a brace out of copper wire and soldered it to the metal shield. And now, the port should have two new pins, which hopefully will keep it in place. And voila, as good as new. Okay, let's continue testing. I will also add a new battery to be able to save BIOS settings. And a compact flash to IDE adapter with 2 GB compact flash cards with pre-installed DOS, tools and some games. Well, the settings are still wrong because I just added the battery and I didn't save the BIOS settings yet. Let's see. Someone noted in the comments to the last video that the BIOS of this board has a huge amount of settings, and I can absolutely confirm it. Would be interesting to go through them one day, but not now. Let's just save and see if this board will boot into DOS at all. And it does. Remember how the post message told something about Celeron 450A? Well, the CPU identification utility says that it is a Celeron 433 at 66 MHz frontside bus, and that is absolutely right. I'd say the BIOS is really outdated. Unfortunately, the Ultimate Retro project didn't provide too much for download for this mainboard. But luckily, Tyan has still its FTP service running, and I could obtain the documentation and more recent BIOS versions too. I already uploaded everything to the project site, including pictures. Let's write the latest BIOS version to an EEPROM and see if something changes. Yep, as you see, now the CPU is detected properly as a Celeron 433. In the notes, it is stated that this board supports CPUs up to Pentium 3 CatMi, probably because of voltage limitations. I have here a Coppermine Pentium 3 CPU, which requires 1.7 volts. Let's see if we get some signs of life with it in this board. Well, this is a partial success. There are postcodes running, that means that the combination works to some extent. Let's see if the CPU is overvolted. Yes, slightly. It is at 1.8 volts instead of required 1.7. But it is an acceptable range. Unfortunately, the display remains black. Probably the board isn't able to fully initialize. This could be again a BIOS and not a hardware issue. I guess this board desperately needs a BIOS fix. But this is probably a topic for another day. And in this repairathon, I have to move on. Important is that this very nice board is completely working. There wasn't much what had to be done. It was very dirty, the keyboard port was broken, and the board was pretty much bent. Luckily, no SMD parts were ripped off, what happens quite often when a PCB gets bent like this. By the way, I left it overnight under some weight in the hope that I will be able to bend it back, but I'm not sure if it had so much effect. The main board is still working, but I'm a little bit afraid to overstress it. Anyway, the board is working and must be one of the fastest AT boards out there. It can be powered with AT and ATX power supplies, it has AGP port, it is based on the fast Intel 440BX chipset, it provides 4 memory slots with up to 1 GB of memory. By the way, the memory slots are in perfect condition. But unfortunately, the CPU slot is slightly damaged, but nothing critical, it works just fine. In the future, I will try to patch the BIOS to get a better CPU support. The CPU voltage circuit seems to deliver voltages down to 1.8 volts. That's not perfect, but should be good enough, and the capacitors are visually in a good condition. Unfortunately, I could not repair the first Intel board, but this one is even more rare due to its form factor, so I am happy with today's outcome. You are welcome to join me in the next part of this repairathon soon, and so far, thank you and goodbye.